Today's video is brought to you by Card Kingdom, and you can pre-order all of the Strixhaven cards you need right now by heading over to cardkingdom.com. Hello everyone, it's Seth, probably better known as Saffron Olive, and it's time for another Daily Dose of Strixhaven Spoilers, and today we have another Mythical Archive focus day, although we do have a few cards from the main set as well, but mostly our focus once again gonna be sweet Mythic Archive reprints, what they're gonna do at Historic. We actually got a bunch of cards to talk about, so we should probably jump right into it, start talking sweet new Strixhaven stuff. And first up today, we have our last not legal in Historic Mythic Archive, which I know I've been pretty critical about Mythic Archives, some of them not being legal in Historic, like Swords to Plowshares and some of those cards, but this is one, Natural Order, that it couldn't be in Historic. 4 mana, sack a greed creature, search for a greed creature, put it on the battlefield. It is a busted sorcery. This is an elf staple all the way back to Legacy, where Natural Order elves is one of the most popular elf archetypes, or at least it has been over the course of the format's history. Also sometimes shows up in like other decks, Maverick and whatnot. The idea is essentially you play a bunch of mana dorks and then you get to 4 mana, then you sack a land of war elves or an elvish mystic and you get a crater hoof, or sometimes you get a Progenitus if you're playing Legacy. And the reason this card has to be banned in Historic is you basically do the same thing. There's a bunch of elf mana dorks, then you have crater hoof behemoths, so it would be super easy for elves to suddenly be the best deck in Historic if they could just flood the board with mana dorks and automatically get crater hoof for 4 mana over and over again. So a sweet reprint, gonna do stuff for Commander, also apparently banned in Brawl, so one of those awkward cards that outside of Limited there's not really any place to play it on Arena, but still a sweet paper reprint, gonna be sweet in Commander decks, gonna be sweet for Legacy players, and looks amazing with the new art and the Mystic Archive border. We also got Divine Gambit. That's right, Divine Gambit as a Mystical Archive. If you're not familiar with Mystical Archives and the idea of them, they're supposed to be the most iconic and powerful spells through Magic's history. I have literally no idea how Divine Gambit made it on the list. Actually, I have an idea. We're going to talk about my idea in just a minute, but Divine Gambit was just printed into Standard, and it was widely mocked. I mean, sure, for 2 mana, you can exile an artifact, a creature, or an enchantment of your opponent's, which is kind of powerful. The problem is you show and tell your opponent they get to put a permanent into play, so yeah, you get rid of one of their things, but then they maybe put a better thing, or at least something into play. So this is a card that I honestly think, seeing it show up as a Mystic Archive, I honestly think Wizards thought this was going to be an exciting card. Like, I think Wizards maybe thought this was like the White Assassin trophy, and this was going to be an in-demand spell that everyone's going to be like, oh my god, this is so good. But it turns out, as soon as it was initially previewed, it was pretty widely mocked as one of the worst spells that was printed in Kaldheim, and now it's pretty widely mocked as one of the worst spells to show up as Mystic Archives. I guess it could also be that Wizards is kind of trolling us. The thing is, sets are built way ahead of time, so I'm sure that by the time Divine Gambit released in Kaldheim, it was already set to be a Mystic Archive. There's no way they saw the community reaction to Kaldheim or like, haha, we'll show them by making it a Mystic Archive. So I really think that Wizards thought this spell was going to be good. I'm not sure why they thought this spell was going to be good, but apparently they thought it was going to be good, and now it's a Mystic Archive, so I don't know. If you want to show and tell your opponent, at least now you can do it in style. We also got Regrowth, which is just one in a green, return a card from your graveyard to your hand, and this is important because it is the best version of this effect. We've seen many similar cards. Nature Spiral, same thing but only hits permanents. Recollect, same thing but +1 mana. Regrowth is the OG original best way to return a card to your hand. The thing is, it doesn't really see play anywhere for the most part, although I will say there could be some shenanigans in Historic and Specific. We've been talking about Wizards adding Storm cards to the format, Tendrils of Agony, Mind's Desire, Grapeshot, and we've been like, okay, that's sweet, but how do you get a Storm count high enough to make Grapeshot work or Tendrils of Agony work? Well, one way you could do that would be if you can get a cost reduction effect on the battlefield, you can just loop 2 copies of Regrowth growth for one mana. Like, back and forth, up your storm count as high as you can for the amount of mana that you have. Maybe use, like, Rowan and Will, some new Strixhaven stuff, Goblin Electromancer, and then you could just storm off, so maybe that's where it could fit. Although, honestly, even with the cost reduction synergy, even with the storm cards, I would guess this is more of a fringe card. We've seen some decks, like, using similar cards to, like, loot the Mirari Conjecture from their graveyard. I think if that's something you're gonna do, Regrowth is the best option for that now. It's just the most efficient, least restricted way to get something back from your graveyard. So my guess is, this will be kind of a fringe fun card. I don't expect this to slot into any tier decks and be like a top tier card in Historic, but it is cool to see it return. It can do some neat things, and I think there will be fringe decks that want to take advantage of Regrowth. Next on our list, we have the card everyone is talking about, Faithless Looting. And people are talking about this card for multiple reasons. One is, it's got some unique art, I would say, to the point where people thought it might have been a troll when it was first spoiled or like some sort of meme. Honestly, I like the art. It reminds me of like an old Adult Swim show or something. Although it seems like a lot of people hate it, so let me know what you think about the Faithless Looting art. Where do you come down with art like this on Magic cards? The other reason that Faithless Looting is a hot topic of conversation is it's a busted card. It's so busted it's banned in Modern, but now it's going to be freed in Historic. And if I was going to pick one Mystic Archive that will have the biggest impact on the Historic format, it probably would be Faithless Looting. And that's saying something, because we're getting a lot of powerful Mystic Archives which are going to shake up the format. The thing about Faithless Looting is, it's so easy to slot into decks. We saw this in Modern, where at first people were like, oh, it's not really card advantage, it's actually card disadvantage. You spend the card and then double loot, that's not very good. But people quickly realize that Faithful Looting is insane. If you have graveyard synergies, it's insane. If you just want to get rid of extra lands, it's insane. It became an ultra staple in the Modern format, and I think it can do the same thing in Historic, because we already have shells for it. Like, we already have Rakdos Arcanist using Kroxa, which wants to be in the graveyard. Young Pyromancer wants you to cast spells. Dreadhorde Arcanist, the namesake card that wants cheap spells in your graveyard. Faithless Looting seems like the ideal card for this deck, and it's already arguably a tier 1 deck, or at least tier 2 deck in the format. Faithless Looting gonna power up this archetype even more. That doesn't even include other archetypes, which are not currently top tier, but might get there because of Faithless Looting. Like Arclight Phoenix, back on the menu. It's two spells in one, it fills your graveyard, it triggers prowess, so I expect we're gonna see Arclight Phoenixes coming back. I wouldn't be surprised to see the cycling decks maybe get better. We already have cycling with like Hollow One and Flameblade Adept being one of the new hot archetypes in the format. Well, Faithless Looting, turn two, cast it, you discard two cards, Hollow One's one mana, it triggers your Flameblade Adept that you cast on turn one to make it three power. Sure, it doesn't have cycling, but it's so synergistic with the rest of the deck that it can probably still work in that shell. And that doesn't even include just like mono red ramp. We see these Planeswalker ramp decks, they're like playing a bunch of Chandras and Ugins. In those decks, you can filter away extra ramp that you don't need, or you can dig for Planeswalker. Sure, it's card disadvantage, but what's card disadvantage in 2021? If there's one thing we've learned from London Mulligans, it's that having the right cards in your hand is more valuable than just having more cards in your hand. So if you're having the right Planeswalker, that's more valuable than just being plus one card. So I think Faithless Looting is the Mystic Archive that is going to have the biggest impact on the Historic format. I actually think it's possible this could be a Mystic Archive that will get banned in Historic eventually. I think it is that impactful. This is going to change everything, powering up existing decks, creating new decks, and I wouldn't be surprised if when we look back on Strixhaven and Mystic Archives in Historic, if Faithless Looting was the most played Mystic Archive out of the entire cycle, which is very impressive. We also got Lightning Helix, and I know Wizards won't let us have Lightning Bolt in Historic, but Lightning Helix is a good constellation prize. Yeah, it's one more mana, but you also gain 3 life, and that is super relevant if you're playing a slower deck against an aggro deck. Right now, if you're playing like Jeskai Control or something like that, you don't have a lot of great stabilization cards. Sure, you got Wrath, but this is your new, like, kill a Burning Tree Emissary, gain 3 life. That is a huge deal. That's kind of a time walk against an aggro deck. Same against random Prowess decks, mono red aggro, even Goblins. This is going to be a go-to removal spell for slower mid-range and control decks that are in the colors, and that doesn't even include that we have burn decks in Historic, and they can easily splash into white. They're normally mono-red, but Lightning Helix is a powerful enough burn spell that I think we'll see Boros Burn become a thing in Historic, adding Lightning Helix to skewer the critics, Wizards, Lightning, all the other burn spells, some aggressive one drops, and just go to town. So Lightning Helix, yeah, it's not quite Lightning Bolt, but this is an insane spell, another one that I expect to have a massive impact on the Historic format. Another really exciting new to Historic card is Mizzix Mastery, and this is a really powerful effect. 4 mana, exile instant or sorcery from your graveyard, and you get to cast it without paying its mana cost. You can overload it, exile all the instants and sorceries from your graveyard for 8 mana, cast all of them, which obviously it's insane when it works. Like, if you can fill your graveyard, get to 8 mana, you're probably going to win the game if you can resolve this. I am more excited, though, about the normal mode. Just 4 mana, cast an instant or sorcery from your graveyard without paying its mana cost. So when you first read this, you're like, I don't know. Historic is a format where people are playing main deck Grafdigger's Cages because of the sacrifice decks. The thing is, because Mizzix Mastery exiles the card rather than letting you cast it from the graveyard, it doesn't actually care about Grafdigger's Cage. So that's step one. The most popular graveyard hate in the Historic format doesn't actually interact with Mizzix Mastery. And then think about what you can do with this card. We have Genesis Ultimatums, Emergent Ultimatums, we have Eerie Ultimatums. There's some really powerful instants and sorceries that if you're casting them for 4 mana rather than 7 mana, probably going to win you the game. Like, think about how this could work. We have Thirst for Knowledge. We have Thirst for Meaning. We have another new Mystic Archive and Compulsive Research, all on curve card draw spells that let you discard cards to get that big ultimatum in your graveyard. Then you can Mizzix Mastery it back into play early in the game. Like, think about this curve. Think about this. It does not seem that hard. Turn 1 Llanowar Elves. Turn 2 Compulsive Research, or any of those card draws spells we are talking about, to discard like Emergent Ultimatum. Turn 3, Mizzix Mastery, Emergent Ultimatum, tutor up your package, win the game on the spot on turn 3. Like, that is a legit thing that you're going to be able to do in Historic. So sure, there's Live the Dream mode, where you could go big, or you could be a Storm deck, where you, like, fill your graveyard with a ton of cantrips and then cast this to storm off. Like, you can go big and do the Live the Dream stuff, but I really think that Mizzix Mastery, just that normal mode, 4 mana, cast an ultimatum from my graveyard really early in the game, that's probably going to be enough, especially since it dodges Grafdigger's Cage, to be a very real, very scary thing in the Historic format. Speaking of storming off, we also got our final missing storm staple. Grapeshot is in Historic. Just one damage to anything, Windstorm. This is one of the main finishers of, like, Modern Storm, for example. Whether or not it can do the same thing in Historic remains to be seen. So we got 3 big storm payoffs coming with Strixhaven to Historic. Grapeshot, the problem is, it's the one that you need the most copies of for it to actually kill your opponent. To win the game with a Grapeshot, if your opponent's at 20, you gotta cast 20 spells in a turn. That's asking a lot in a format that doesn't have access to various rituals, free spells. So I kind of think that Grapeshot might be the weakest of the storm cards in Historic in specific, just because we don't have access to the rituals that really power it up. However, I don't know. There are ways to storm off. We see, like, pseudo-storm decks using Paradox Engine to untap mana rocks and so forth. Back and forth, back and forth. Could Grapeshot work in a deck like that? It certainly could, although whether it's better than, I don't know, playing Aetherflux Reservoir, and then you could take advantage of Emry to loop your Mind Stones and Karn to tutor it out. Whether Grapeshot's better than that, I'm honestly not sure. So, I don't know. I kind of think that Grapeshot is the weakest of the Storm cards. That doesn't mean it's bad. If there's one thing I've learned from Pauper, it's that Storm players are going to Storm. If you can make Sprouting Vines actually be a legitimate Storm card when it just tutors a land into your hand, I gotta think Storm players are going to figure out a way to take advantage of Grapeshots and Tendrils and Mind's Desire. Although, if I was going to rank these 3 Storm cards, Grapeshot is actually the worst of the bunch, I think, in Historic, because it takes the highest Storm count. There's not a super easy way to get that Storm count, outside of maybe Mizzix Mastery, which we talked about. Not a super easy way to do it, unless you're playing artifact stuff, and then I think you just play Aetherflux Reservoir anyway. So it's going to be really interesting to see Storm's impact. We have the literal best Storm cards in the history of Magic entering the format, but we don't have any of the literal best, or even close to the best, or even very bad support cards available in the format. So it's going to be very interesting to see how Storm shakes out. I think people are going to try it. Whether or not it ends up being good or not, I don't know, but never underestimate Storm players, because they have a long history of making it work no matter how bad their Storm cards are, and these are the actual best Storm cards in Magic's history. We also got Increasing Vengeance, which just copies a spell for 2 mana, and then you can double copy it for 4 mana, which, I don't know. I don't really think this is a constructed card. Maybe you can do something with Magecraft coming in Strixhaven because it cares about copying, but I expect this to mostly be like a Brawl card where you can copy your Time Warps or your Elrond's Epiphany, your Genesis Ultimatum, so there are good things to copy, but in general, these spell copying effects have never really made their way into constructed Magic outside of some really fringe janky combo decks, so maybe we can do some sweet against the odd stuff with it, but I think this is something focused mostly on Historic Brawl rather than something that's going to be a staple in Historic proper. Next on our list, we got Tainted Pact, which is a pretty unique card. This is a card that doesn't usually see play in 60 card formats. It's kind of like a weird demonic tutor, except it wants your deck to be singleton. You cast it for 2 mana at instant speed if you want to. Exile the top card of your library. You can keep doing that until you either hit 2 of the same card, then it stops and fizzles, or you put a card into your hand. So essentially, if you're playing a 100 card singleton deck and you don't have any duplicates in your deck, this is a demonic tutor that'll find you the card that you want, but it's going to exile a bunch of cards along the way. On the other hand, if you're playing a normal deck where you're playing 4 copies of a bunch of cards, a lot of the times this is going to be like a bad cantrip, or it's just going to fizzle outright if you dig too far trying to find what you want. The other thing about this card is it's going to be banned alongside demonic tutor in Brawl, so you're not even going to be able to play it in Brawl, which is probably a good thing because Brawl is a singleton format. There are some combos that this would enable. Maybe you can play a Lutri deck for fun. Like, this would be a good tutor in a Lutri deck. So Lutri already wants you to play all singletons. So, I mean, Lutri has proven itself to be probably the weakest of the companions. But still, if you want to take the Lutri challenge, Tainted Pact would be good there. The other thing to mention about Tainted Pact is you can just use it to exile your deck. Like, if you're playing a singleton deck and you're not going to hit any duplicates, you can just keep exiling forever until all your cards are gone. And then you can cast a Thassa's Oracle to win the game. So that's a trick from like CDH decks where Tainted Pact Thassa's Oracle is just an insta win, little harder to pull off in constructed formats like in Historic, let's say, because in Historic it's going to be a big restriction to play singleton cards like see Lutri, which hasn't caught on in any format, and it probably means you can only play one Thassa's Oracle, because if you play multiple Thassa's Oracles you'll hit that with your Tainted Pact and fizzle it. So I don't know, maybe there could be some weird like Lutri Grixis Thassa's Oracle combo deck where you just hope to tutor up your Thassa's Oracle, hope to tutor up your Tainted Pact, exile your entire deck, win the game that way. But my guess is it's kind of just a Commander reprint, a CDH-focused reprint. It's not legal in Brawl. It's never been good in 60-card formats. So my guess is this doesn't really see any play on Arena, but who knows? Maybe there's some combo with Lutri or Thassa's Oracle. Maybe people can figure out how to make it work in Historic, and it's devastating, because it is technically a 2-card combo. It's just a 2-card combo that's not consistent, because you only get to play 1 copy of every card in your deck if you want to make it work. We also got Tezzeret's Gambit, just 4 mana, draw 2, proliferate, except one of that mana is Phyrexian mana, so technically you cast it for 3 generic mana in 2 life, which means it's a divination for any color, which I don't know if any color having a divination is actually all that exciting in Historic. However, if you can take advantage of the proliferate, it gets much better. Maybe you're playing Kezmina Super Friends after Strixhaven releases, and you're trying to go off with these Planeswalkers, then being able to add a loyalty counter to each of your Planeswalkers and draw 2 cards for 3 mana, that's actually really powerful. The other possibility would be we have seen like Windy Constrictor Conclave Mentor decks that are putting counters on everything. If you can proliferate and you have one of those out, it's going to be a ton of counters, grow your board really quickly. A little bit awkward because the decks normally don't have too much room for utility spells because they're collecting company decks, which means they need like 30 creatures for Coco to work, and then you're kind of limited to like very few utility slots. But still, Tezzeret's Gambit could be powerful in a +1/+1 counter theme deck, so we'll see. Tezzeret's Gambit is a card I really like. I don't think it's going to be a new staple of Historic, but I do think there might be some decks that can take advantage of it. As far as the rest of our Mystic archives, we got a few reprints. Infuriate, we have God's Willing, Agonizing Remorse, Eliminate. They're already in Historic. Some of them see a little bit of play already. So, mostly just wanted to show them off so you could see the sweet art. Finally, as far as main set cards, just a few commons and uncommons. Star Pupil, not a bad one drop. A 1-mana 0/0 comes into play with a counter. When it dies, you can put a counter on a creature you control. Could see play in some sort of Conclave Mentor +1/+1 counter deck. The only drawback is, I think it's just worse than Swarm Shambler and Stonecoil Serpent, which are also really good in the same style of deck, so I don't know if there's enough room for Star Pupil to show up even in the decks where it would be good, so I'm guessing mostly support for the +1/+1 counter archetype in Limited, but who knows? In a +1/+1 counter deck, it's not that far away from being constructed playable, or maybe it's a budget replacement on Arena. Like, if you don't have the wild cards for Swarm Shambler or Stonecoil Serpent, Star Pupil might be the next best one drop that you could play in a +1/+1 counter deck. Is it going to be as good? No, but it's also going to cost you a common wild card rather than a rare. So I think that's where Star Pupil fits. We also got a bunch more learn cards, with the most exciting being Field Trip, just 3 mana, Rampant Growth out a basic forest, put it right into play tapped, which is actually not bad. 3-mana ramp is close enough. We see like Beanstalk Giant, 3-mana ramp with upside, often can see play. And you get to learn, so you get to tutor a lesson from your sideboard. We only got one new lesson to talk about, which is Environmental Sciences, but it's actually kind of an interesting one. It's 2 mana, search your library for a basic land, reveal, put it in your hand, then shuffle your library, you gain 2 life. So this is actually pretty close to decent fixing for like a 5-color deck, especially on a budget. The life gain is nice, so I don't think that any of these cards are going to be like super staples in best of 3, but in best of 1, I'm actually really hyped for the archetype, and it's certainly going to be interesting and Limited as well. Plus, keep your eyes out for really good lessons. So far, we've seen 1 rare, we've seen a bunch of random commons and uncommons, which do add value, but are not super efficient. They're mostly like 1 mana more than you would want to pay for the effect, so we'll have to see. If we get something that's really strong, that is a lesson, or a super playable learn card, then the value of these cards might go up, and maybe we see them in best of 3 sideboards as well. Anyway, that brings us to the end of our daily Strixhaven spoilers for today. So what do you think about the rest of these Mystic archives? What's going to happen to Historic once this set comes out? What about the main set stuff? Let me know about that. The Faithless Looting art, what's your opinion? How awesome is it? How much do you hate it? Let me know that in the comments as well. And we will be back on Monday, when we should be back to main set spoilers. We have gotten every Mystic archive, so those are out of the way. Next week, we'll be focused exclusively on stuff coming to Standard and Modern and Legacy and Commander with Strixhaven proper. So we'll be back with that on Monday. Until then, have a great weekend, everyone. Thanks so much for watching, and I will talk to you soon. Dying for more spoiler coverage? Well, we've got you covered with daily spoiler videos every single day during spoiler season. Plus, you can always find the latest by heading over to mtgpreviews.com.